All right.
Welcome to this stream. We are Campo Santo. We are some of Campo Santo.
We are about 20% of Campo Santo. My name is Sean Vanaman.
I'm Chris Remo.
And we're joined by Jane Ng, who's sitting in here. And we showed our first game ever, Firewatch, at PAX this weekend. And now we want to show it again for you here.
Yeah, from our office.
From our office.
The game is made.
Pretty much right here. We have one computer.
Uh-huh.
We just make it here. We all kind of take turns.
We talk at each other into a camera.
Mm-hmm. You come in, you watch the video of the person who's here last, so you
right.
learn what they did.
Yeah.
It's a very unorthodox
like,
way of making games.
It's iterative. Game
it's like our Dogma 95.
When people say game design is iterative, that's what they mean.
This is exactly what they mean.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's, cause, I mean, if more people are working at once, that's not really iteration. That's
no, you're wasting a lot of work because you don't know
what other people are doing.
What other people are doing.
Right.
We don't, for example, we don't know what we're doing, as you can tell. Let's play a video game.
Yeah, so this is Firewatch. You'll see what it is. It's first person, but you play as this guy, Henry, who kind of retreats from his life, his kind of crappy life, to take this job as a fire lookout in the middle of the Wyoming wilderness in 1989. The year before that were the like Yellowstone fires in 1988. Those are real fires that happened. You can go read about them. There were these devastating forest fires that became this sort of like political fulcrum in the United States at the time. So this job is in high demand. Henry takes it for the sole purpose of getting away. And the game is about building a relationship with your supervisor, a woman named Delilah, who is also doing the job in a nearby tower. But she's the one who relays all of your messages to sort of like the Forest Service and anyone beyond. The demo is going to start right here. And you are in your first full day on the job, but have probably played the game for a little while.
10 minutes?
Yeah. There's a prologue where you experience some of Henry's backstory, and then there's
some choices about his life.
Yeah, kind of arriving at the tower and sort of getting situated and meeting Delilah for the first time. So this is after all that's happened, and you kind of wake up on the morning, but it's actually the afternoon of your first day.
Mm-hmm.
So Jake was the one driving the PAX demo, so now I'm driving it. We're going to be showing you pretty much all the same content, unless I accidentally just start doing different stuff.
Straight up same build we brought to PAX.
Yeah.
Exact same build.
And we're showing you like our most polished stuff, so you'll see that there's a lot of possibility space in the game, but I'm just going to show you the stuff that I think looks the best right now. Mm-hmm. So
it'll probably differ in tiny ways from what Jake did.
Yeah, I'm a different
human. Inevitably.
Yeah, inevitably, yes. So it's this one? Yeah. All right. This. I look down.
Good afternoon, sleepyhead.
Yeah, Jesus. I guess it's what, 6?
6:45.
Whoops.
Don't worry about it. That hike puts everyone out of commission for a day or two. Anyway, you want to learn about being a lookout? Great! There's a thing in the middle of your tower with a round map on it. Do you see it?
So I do see it, but what if I just don't talk about it? Some stuff around.
It's right in the middle of your room.
Hold on, I'm gonna get rid of this. So I'm just gonna go out here. I can just go over there.
You can't miss it.
Okay, Delilah really wants me to do my job. I'll throw that over there.
Okay, yeah, I see it.
This is the Osborne Firefinder, invented in 1914 by W.B.
Osborne?
Ah, yes.
Sorry.
You use this to spot, you guessed it, fire. What the fuck?
What is it?
Nothing. You use this to. Oh, fuck me! Out your west facing window. Are you seeing what I'm seeing? Are those fucking fireworks?
Whoa, that's not legal, right?
No. You need to get down there right now and stop them. Fire danger is through the fucking roof.
Is that really my job?
Your job is whatever I say it is. The closest ranger is like 2 days away. Go down there and set him straight.
I kind of want to take the book with me.
Yeah, do it. Why not? That's hilarious.
I'm not really a disciplinarian type of guy.
Well, make him knock it off without smoking a joint, okay?
Sure. All right.
Good. Get going. You'll probably need a rope to get down the shale between you and the lake, if I remember right. There should be one in the supply box on the way. The code is 1234. It's actually that for all of them.
Smart.
Shut up.
So you can see you have, like, time dialogue choices, and just, it's not readily apparent right now, but, like, not saying anything to Delilah when she calls you, or when you call her with a prompt and just not responding is totally valid inside of the game.
Yep.
So we're walking down to get a rope so we can climb down to get to where we think these people are lighting off fireworks in the middle of a very, very dry and hot summer. And feel free to ask questions in chat. We'll try to address them as we play or afterwards. Probably during, otherwise we'll just be sitting on camera.
Yeah. We can run like a section where we just answer some questions.
Yeah.
I found the supply box.
Great.
So are there a lot of these out in the woods?
Yeah, we got them all over the Shoshone. He saved us a lot of back and forth from the trailhead. Don't take all the good stuff.
Yeah, all right.
So, yeah, if I bring up my radio, I can start talking about these things as I scroll over them. So...
Do people lose their shit doing this job? There's a note that says a guy just left his post.
It happens, yeah. You're not gonna pop your top, are you, Henry?
I wasn't planning on it. I tracked down that rope. It was right where you said.
Great. So you should be set to get down to the lake.
Yeah, I get the sense that not everything in here is useful.
In the boxes? Why's that?
I don't really know what I'll do with the deer horn.
Firstly, they're called antlers, and secondly, stay out here long enough and you'll get creative.
I go this way? Is this the way we're gonna go?
Okay. Seems like the way to go.
Yeah. I could go the other way, just so we're all clear. This is the way I could go.
You go any way you like, Sean.
It's my game. It's our game. This is my playthrough, though.
Hey, when you got in last night, I'm sorry for just launching into the what the hell's wrong with you shit.
So now Delilah's like waiting for a response, and I could choose to respond to her or not.
Like, bring it up so they can see the timer.
Yeah.
Just gonna let it
It was kind of shitty, yeah.
I'll talk to her
Yeah, I know. That's why I'm sorry. We got started off on the wrong foot, and I want you to feel like we can talk. It's important.
People are asking
the isolation gets to people.
Paths.
You think you'll take to it? Being out here?
So
I'm just not gonna respond to her, so she'll take that as me not wanting to talk about this.
There are clear.
Well, I guess if you can't, it'll be obvious. I'm sorry again.
There are clear areas like these big rock formations where those are definitely impassable, but the paths are mainly there for convenience. You can definitely just walk through the brush and plants and things if you want. We don't want to make a game where we have just obnoxious invisible walls that don't seem realistic or believable. So, yeah, you should be able to walk in places where it clearly feels like you should be.
Yeah. So there's a whole bunch more traversal stuff that we're going to wait and show you guys on a later stream. So I'm going to jump forward in time. This is not part of the game, what you're about to see, and bring us down towards where these guys are doing this. But like traversal and like I got that rope that would have allowed me to get down to here is part of what opens up the game as we go forward. So you can think of it a lot like
a Batman game or a Metroid or something like that. Mm-hmm. A little bit.
Is there a pretty area over here? Yeah, there's another path for you. So I can see what I think is probably a campsite up here.
Finding a bunch of empty beer cans. They threw them all over hell.
The idiots down at the lake?
Yeah, them. I just found where they're hanging out. What do you know? People with shitty manners drink shitty beer.
what? You don't like a cold Musqua light on a hot day?
No, no, I do. But then again, I didn't say my manners were anything.
I always feel like I need to clean this place up, which you totally can.
Yeah, but you don't have time to, so fuck it.
You know what? Fuck it. I'm not the maid. Oh, look, they decided to have a campfire, too.
You know, they color-coded the fire danger signs in case people were illiterate. But I guess that doesn't take into account just plain stupid, does it?
They left half a bottle of whiskey. Decent stuff.
Drunk pyromaniacs. Fucking great.
Oh, shit. Ferret or Irish?
Ferret or Irish? Oh, only the best. only the finest. We're gonna hold on to this. So this is something we can take with us. Which we will, because it's delicious and alcohol is great. Kids, sorry.
Found the fireworks. They didn't even try to hide them.
Well, confiscate them.
Some quality packaging there. Done by.
Someone's asking about potential release date. We're just saying 2015 right now. We don't have any more specific plans in that, but definitely next year.
I found a bra.
A nudie pyromaniac. Remain professional.
There are, panties.
There are what?
I don't want to say that word again.
Why, because you're 12?
There's a... Ooh.
Yes? You should probably tell these people off, and then head back.
But...
And if you see a penis, you're gonna have to deal with that too.
No, see, they're...
Just deal with it, Henry.
Hey, you fucking kids!
Hey, you fucking fatso! Leave us alone!
I found them in the lake.
Skinny dipping?
Yeah.
Is that a guy over there?
Oh boy! Enjoy dealing with that!
So we could do a lot of things here. We could engage them in conversation. We could just bounce.
Yeah, you can leave.
We can do many things, but I feel like this is the most fun thing to do in the game right now.
Full stereo!
Whoa! Hey, put that down! Seriously, it was expensive!
Yeah, well, out here, fireworks aren't just stupid, please, they're illegal.
Please, just put it down! We won't fight anymore, okay? You asshole! What a fucking shit!
Womp womp.
All right, so there's another part where we would hike all the way back and do a bunch of traversal to get back up to our tower as the time changes. But we're going to zip around that as well.
Yeah. And like Esron was saying, there's a lot of ways you could have resolved or not resolved that situation. You could have just taken the boombox, marched off with it as it just blared into your ear, called Delilah about it. You could have not done anything. You could have just straight up left. And
you have a long conversation with them just about like why you wouldn't light fireworks in the middle of the woods.
You can deal with that in a lot of different ways. And you can also tell Delilah a lot of different things about it. So you don't, like, the things you can say to Delilah are not necessarily restricted to only the things you actually did. Like, you have a lot of freedom in how you respond to these situations. So this is obviously, you know, sometime.
Yeah. This is quite a bit later. You've probably talked to Delilah a bit more. You've had a sort of a strange encounter, and now you're home.
What can I do for you?
Well, my typewriter is on the ground, outside of my tower.
You write?
Yeah, look, the wind? No. How the hell...
You should get inside.
Fuck me.
Oh, you should be able to walk, Sean.
Someone broke in.
Hey, what?
They wrecked the place. Threw my typewriter out the window. Motherfucker!
Henry, calm down. I'll let the Forest Service know what happened.
I'm gonna have to fix the window.
Tomorrow, Henry. You won't be cold.
Pick some stuff. I'll pick up this one.
Okay, I put in a call.
Put my one book away.
My fucking sheets are gone.
God, I'm sorry. That's so shitty. Do you have any idea who would have done this?
So yeah, then you would probably have some ideas of who would have done this based on the way you played the game and the sort of experiences that you had in getting back to your tower.
Yeah.
So the game is a mystery game. I think that's sort of important to point out because describing what this game is to people is like not simple.
It's a challenge.
Yeah. So it's definitely a first-person mystery where a lot of the ways you interact with this other person define the relationship and the way you feel and experience about the things that are happening to you.
Mm-hmm.
We're still pretty early in development. There's like 10 of us here. But yeah, I guess if you have any questions, we can start talking about some of those.
Ask things.
Do you have things that are...
A bunch of people just said how cool the music was.
Well, we actually farmed that out to a house in Burundi. No, Chris did the music.
Here's a question. Ninja Squirrel says, does time progress naturally or is it a level thing? So time progresses basically according to the narrative with a couple like kind of little exceptions. Essentially, this is a very narrative-oriented game, and so there are a lot of times where we want things to happen at particular times of day. So, like, we want you to find your tower when it is kind of ominous and the storm's coming on and it's, you know, getting dark and so on. And so that's when that happens in the story. But there are moments where we want something to happen as the sun is setting. And so, you know, over a period of, like, a believable period of time, like, the game will actually progress through that time of day. But it's not like an actual constantly ticking 24-hour day-night cycle. You're not going to just sit there and like 4 days will pass if you let the game run for 20 hours or whatever.
Yeah,
so,
totally.
So we're it's, you know, it's what the narrative needs it to be, plus just kind of some environmental like convincing.
Yeah. Some really quick questions that are easy to answer. This is being done in Unity. It will be on Steam. It will not be Early Access or Greenlight. It'll just be a game that comes out.
It'll be done. You can buy it. You can play it.
Yes. We have a pretty traditional funding model in that sense. So you're welcome, Neural.
Is there NC Games, is there rocket jumping? Yes, that is your sole means of movement.
Of conveyance, absolutely. Yeah. Henry actually can't walk. He can only rocket jump inside of his paralyzed capsule that he lives inside of.
WM Gaming 21 says, any way to contact the developers?
Hello.
well, for one, you're doing it.
Success.
So the answer is yes. But also we have a development blog at blog.camposanto.com that we update fairly regularly with bits from development, from just like fun things around the office, progress shots, things like that. And we have comments there that we frequently check in and respond to. So that's a pretty good way to get in contact with us. Particularly if you're trying to contact a particular person from the team, you can always comment on a post that is made by them. But also we're all on Twitter. You can get us at Camposanto on Twitter. We have a Facebook page, like all the normal stuff, I guess.
Ewok's Kick asked, is the mystery more than just to be broken in a tower? And the answer is absolutely. The way I think mysteries are interesting is when enough small things start to plant the seed of an inconceivable bigger thing. And that's sort of the style of mystery this is. Is that a good example? I mean, is that a good description?
Absolutely. The tower break-in is like the precipitating event for your character more than it is the entire mystery.
It's weird in that, like, the things that have... If you think of the specifics of the things that have happened to that tower, if you were in that exact situation, you'd say, well, that's bizarre, and we want to keep doing that while escalating the things that happened to you across the story of the game.
And the game is also about how your... Like, what these external events mean for the relationship you have with Delilah, which is obviously, like, you know, probably the most significant gameplay mechanic of the game, is your constant interaction with Delilah and your ability to kind of guide that relationship in those conversations. And so the game is also about what it means for weird events that start going on to actually impact that relationship. In ways that are hopefully entertaining and interesting.
Man, so many good questions. This is like insane. I don't know who... There's another Campo who's on the account right now who's answering questions in text.
I think it might be Jake.
But one of the questions was, who would win Miss Congeniality at Campo Santo, which I would say was either James or Jane.
Yeah.
And that is exactly what Jake has said already. Oh my gosh, let me look. We're going to have to do a lot of these because there's some really good questions for people who aren't even for us.
I really want to do more. You should, I will say this very self-servingly, you should subscribe to our Twitch channel if you find this interesting, because we do already have plans that we've been talking about just like yesterday to do more streams with other members of the team and other aspects of the game, like in the very near future. So if you follow us on Twitch at Campo Santo or Twitter, or whatever,
I'm just like over
see
like
stuff about that. We'll
basking in questions. Somebody asked if you had looked at the other pair of underwear first, if the text would change. It's sort of a design decision. It obviously can. Like, a lot of the way we design the game is, okay, if you do this first, then this is what happens second. A good example of that is when you go down to the, when you first get down to the campsite and you say, oh, I found a bunch of empty beer cans. Delilah has no idea where you are. So that's a thing that I'm tracking as I write the game. And if you remember that dialogue, I think he says, like, I'm finding a bunch of empty beer cans. I threw them all over hell. And she says, the idiot's down at the lake? And he goes, yeah, I found where they're hanging out. So had you just like blown past the beer cans, or picked one up and then thrown it down, or picked one up and put them all away, not told Delilah, and then gone and reported about the campfire, it would have been a different conversation because she's learning like where you are. So with the underpants, he would talk about them as if he had only, if it was the first pair he found. So he'd say something like, there's some underwear out here, as opposed to, I have found another set, things like this.
Mm-hmm.
But the actual them would probably stay the same. My design brain is figuring it out. I don't really know what I did in the game, to be perfectly honest. Because Henry has already seen the first one, the way we designed the level. So you as the character know that it's another one, but he probably wouldn't talk about it.
Right,
like,
but the context of what that means for Delilah, it's still the first one he's talked about with.
Yeah, which is a really hard problem on a game
it
like
is.
This. I had never done anything like that before. It's a challenge. It's really hard.
So I feel like that ties into this question from Azodia, who says, how much design was done up front for this game versus discovering it as you go? I would say, in terms of like the practicalities of the design, it's almost all been as we go. The premise has been very similar to what I guess you mainly originally conceived. And like the characters and setting have all been pretty consistent. But all this stuff that Sean is talking about on the design side, those things constantly, like, we have to sort through that stuff all the time, both from a like content and design standpoint and from a technical standpoint, because all of the actual systems that we're designing and that are being implemented by people like Will Armstrong, our programmer, like, they need to allow for the specific use cases that the game needs to support. And like, that means you have to actually figure out what all those are. And sometimes those assumptions will be contradicted by, say, doing a playtest and realizing,
right,
like, oh my God, people have all these different things they want to do that we didn't foresee, because that always happens in every game.
Yeah, I mean, all the stuff you saw and that I commented about was all stuff that was sort of a byproduct of people playing the game. Oh, I want to put the fire out. Oh, I want to clean up the campsite. Oh, I want to chuck this thing in the lake because these kids are a-holes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I want to clean up the
And especially if you interact with the teens more, like, the reason we don't talk to them a lot, to be completely honest, is we only have one of them recorded. So it was too weird to have it the way we wanted it. I mean, and we didn't want to play the game with subtitles because we think it's a cooler experience to play without it. But, yeah, that was all stuff that people play the game and say, oh, I want to be able to do this. And we say, oh, yeah, we should do that because that makes the game interesting. I was going to say something. Oh, yeah. That's very counter to the way I know how to make games. So Jake and I made episodic games at Telltale for a long time.
Real quick, someone wants to know if this game will be episodic, and the answer is no.
No, the answer is not. Yeah.
Single game, anyway.
Yes, this is a single game. And when you make episodic games, you generally have to know everything you're going to do. You have to get it pretty right in the design phase, because there's other teams behind you in line who need to make their game. So I kind of came at this that way, where I was like, oh, I'm just going to imagine everything and get it right the first time. And then that was really stupid. So because people played the game and I was wrong, because the game is a bit more systems driven. So now I'm just not doing that as much. We get the core content down. I don't beat myself up over it, not having a ton of content in the game. And then we just let people play it and let the team play it. And then we layer content in. So that's the way we're going to continue development. But I definitely wrote a bunch of stuff early on that was for people who don't exist, you know, like content that's like, oh, that'd be interesting because people want to do that, and then nobody wanted to do it, so there's no point in putting it in the game.
Totally. So Faust says, since it's a mystery, is it possible to draw the wrong conclusion, either by missing something or just not finding a certain clue, and have the game end differently because of it?
You should answer that.
Okay. So this is a game where we're looking at the kind of player choice and responsiveness stuff as more creating a responsive world and allowing you to express your own intent and kind of like reactions than we are like a literally branching plot where you have ending A and ending B, or like the good ending and the bad ending. That's not what this game is. It's not like an RPG with eight different endings and so on and so on. The major events of the plot will happen regardless, but your reactions to them and the way you express yourself within the context of those actions and within the world can be like very different. Which I think relates directly to the thing about drawing wrong conclusions. Like, I would personally, I can't speak for Sean, but to me, the thing we're making feels like it has a lot more in common with, like, a film noir mystery story or a 70s era kind of psychological thriller than it does, like, a Sherlock Holmes mystery story. And
yeah.
To me, that former category is all about drawing wrong conclusions and the all of the fallout and kind of clutter that results from the protagonist coming to incorrect conclusions rather than sort of beautiful minding it to the...
Yeah, I mean, so much of the thing that you're going to be in control over is...
Actually, I guess a beautiful mind, he does totally come to a lot of wrong conclusions. So.
Well, he's crazy.
He's totally nuts.
Spoiler. God, I spoil a lot of movies. I spoil
ghost.
A lot of movies in this room.
Yeah.
This is like the place where I come to do that, apparently.
Yeah.
The thing that you're going to have the most control over is the way you communicate about your what actions you take, how you communicate about your actions to Delilah, and then how you choose to respond to the things that she posits, either about what's happening to you guys or just about her life or your life in general.
Mm-hmm. Which I feel like is true to how most of us live our lives,
yes.
Right? Like, the actual fallout of decisions we make in our lives tends to reverberate with the people we know, as opposed to, like, I made this decision and now this house isn't here, which is often what it is in like an RPG or something. Like,
yeah,
like,
plant a tree.
Right, exactly. But like this game, we're really trying to drill down into your relationship with Delilah, your ability to react to things in the world. Like, we want the game to be responsive more than branching. It's not so much like a bunch of discrete branches. It's like constant responsiveness is what we're going for.
Yeah. Will Goldstone has asked, how do you reconcile the accusation no one has made that this is Far Cry 2 without guns, and will anything be rolling down a hill? To which I would offer one anecdote of Jake coming back to his messed out tower, picking up the fire extinguisher and chucking it off the balcony. Were you there for that? And it just rolled forever down the hill, and he just watched it from, like, Delilah's talking in his ear, and he stood at the railing, and it just went, like, out of view. It was just like the perfect moment.
Yeah.
That's like really fun, by the way, about making games like this. Then it's like, because right there, he could go through the dialogue enough to where the day would end, and I think that's the way it's designed right now. So then it would just be him watching this thing, throwing this thing off of anger, watching this thing, not responding to Delilah because he's so mad, and then just go to sleep. It was like such a good moment. I'm like, okay, that's a good story.
For sure. Voosh TV says, is it possible to show part of the development process on a later stream?
Totally.
And yeah, we definitely have plans to do that.
It's hard for some disciplines. It's probably...
hard for programming, most of all.
Yeah. And we don't want to give away anything in the story accidentally. And I usually, my screen is like, has all the shit on it. So it'll probably, I can see that Jane wants to do stuff. Right, Jane?
Yeah.
That was good.
Jane is actually really good at development live streams. And I know this because we worked together at Double Fine where we did a bunch of those. And she was like an all-star on those. So
something actually we're going to put a blog post up about. It was an idea Ollie had at PAX, which is... we're still fleshing out the interior of the tower. Like, not. It's also worth reiterating. Nothing you're seeing is like done. Like, this is in. This is where it's playing. Like, the latest build.
Mm-hmm.
And we're always happy when it doesn't break. But we're gonna keep fleshing out the interior of the tower. So I think Ollie wants to do a thing where we open up a chat channel on the blog where people propose a thing that Henry can maybe have on his bedside table. You guys will, if you have ideas, put them in there, and then Ollie or whoever will pick one, he'll draw it, and then Jane will model it, and then we'll put it into the game and chuck it off the balcony or something for you.
Yeah, we'll Twitch me.
Yeah, and we'll Twitch all that. That stuff will all be done on Twitch.
So Memo has kind of a funny question, which is, we're going to have to try this at some point. Can you play the game and progress being mostly silent to Delilah whenever you get the dialogue options?
Yeah,
I mean,
you can
like,
do that long day.
Game's not going to stop you.
Yeah,
We'll probably have to... It would be a one of the weirder playthroughs, but like.
But it's also not like. Sorry, Tim. It's really warm.
No,
right,
sure.
It's kind of off. It's also not. I'm gonna try not to flash everyone. Completely, it's not so difficult for me to track that stuff. Like, enough silent choices can increment a threshold where I can make Delilah say like, "You really don't talk very much." I'll write something better than that. But a good example is. Like, I think there's a way to make that playthrough really fulfilling, even though it's, like, 1% of players will just decide to be, like, the silent Henry. It's always interesting to me when people have chosen to be silent for a while and then pipe up, and then the game says, oh, like, I've noticed you care about this, but you didn't care about all those other things,
mm-hmm.
Really explicitly. I find that stuff to be really cool.
And that question, I think, speaks to other stuff that we've had to think about a lot in designing this game. Because it is a narrative-oriented game, and the events of the game will happen in a certain order. But, you know, it's a big contiguous world, and it's definitely possible to go places before the story indicates you should, you know, before Delilah suggests you do so, or whatever. Or before you've seen anything in the events that transpire that suggests there's something over there. And so a lot of the discussions we have about design and about gating and about, like, world and object interaction are concerned with, like, what if players just do things differently than how the kind of, like, canonical playthrough would be. Not that there is one of those, but there's not really any, like, easy answer to those questions other than just figuring them out on a case-by-case basis, because anything that's just, like, a one-size-fits-all answer wouldn't be convincing, and that's equally true for just never saying anything to Delilah. Like, you want something there that Sean actually writes to be appropriate and convincing for that situation, and that's kind of the tag we have to take in every case when it comes to things that fall maybe outside the like 80-90%, you know, like player base. Like,
yeah, you can be a pack rat for sure.
Unit number 5 says, yeah, can I be a terrible, crazy pack rat like I am in John Holm? Yep,
yeah, there's actually, you have a backpack, so abilities like there's certain things you're gonna find, like ropes and packs of ropes and climbing equipment, and we have a design, but not implemented, like fireman's axe. It's called a Pulaski. It's used for digging and chopping stuff down or whatever. That'll allow you to expand the world. So those things are like abilities and will be readily apparent on your pack. And then your pack will actually live in your tower. So you'll actually see it because it's stupid that you would not see it on your back in first person. And then there are objects like the whiskey that I picked up. I could pick up all those beer cans. I could pick up a lot of other stuff. Might be able to pick up the underwear.
Jane also recently added some things to the game that allow you to take stuff from your tower put them into the outhouse in sort of assigning.
Yeah.
Like, we have a system. We have a system of the game that we basically ripped off from Gone Home. This is one area where a game actually does share a very specific thing with Gone Home, which is the putback system. So instead of just only kind of physics throwing objects around, you can put them back in specific places that are appropriate for them to be. And Jane outfit the outhouse with a bunch of those for like the antler and toilet paper.
You know, and your whiskey and the granola bar. It's all there.
Right. So you've got your weird little den in the outhouse.
I don't like
okay,
that.
You want
I like that. And then I don't. The whiskey and the granola bar is actually something that I would do and not tell anybody.
Yeah, I was
going
to say, not hitting too close to home.
That is a little.
Yeah.
I have a reputation.
Someone says, who said, I forget who asked this, but someone asked if there are fail states. There's no, like, fail state in the sense of a game over thing. There's nothing like that. You don't die. You don't lose. If you make a decision in the game that feels like a bad decision because of what it means to Delilah and to your situation or whatever, that's just what happens in your playthrough of the game. But you're not going to, like, fall off a cliff and die. That's
no.
not what this is just not what this game is.
That doesn't make any because I will literally just find ways to break the game, so I'll start in a non-logic state. But I didn't know because there's some people who haven't seen the gameplay. If I should.
Oh yeah, a bunch of people got here after we
just
started
walk
playing,
around in the tower.
Playing the game. Yeah, just load up the game. Why not?
Okay. If you're just tuning in now, I'm walking around in a probably not alive world. I'm literally just gonna be in the environment. Otherwise, I'll like
yeah.
Delilah will start calling us, and it'll be hard to speak over that and things like this. So. Don't judge this. Jake kicks down the door and goes, what are you doing? this is going to be fun.
Shaz Wazer says, did you talk about voice actor casting yet?
Yeah.
Yeah, we have, actually, as of today, I guess.
As of like an hour ago. Yeah.
So Henry is being played by Rich Sommer, who you may know as Harry Crane from Mad Men. And Delilah is being played by Sissy Jones, who has worked on a lot of things, but you may... remember as Katya from The Walking Dead. Jake's...
What are you doing?
So you can see this. This is the way we build our demos, by the way, as you can see.
You're showing them everything.
What, even our like debug test looks nice in world UI because Jake is crazy.
Fireworks logo font.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, man. Mario actually won. It's accusing us of ripping off Far Cry 2's visual style.
That's one of the nicest things anybody's
yeah,
ever
I mean,
said
that, was, that wasn't intentional, but I don't know if I could be happier to have ripped off a different stuff.
Yeah. Man, even the color... Are the color lines even ready? Because I'm not inside of color.
Sure.
Let's see.
Getting deep here.
What? I'm just going on a walk, guys. Just going on a walk.
Yes.
Go back to work. You're nervous.
Are you going to take that all the way down to the...
I was thinking about taking it to the canyon. I'm not gonna take it all the way down to the canyon. I'm just going to take it to the canyon. And then we go
can
back.
Walk, you can walk the different way this time.
Yeah, I'll do that. I mean, I could also just go off in the room. Yeah. But look, you made this area look good, Jane.
Yeah, okay.
What do you mean? You're working really closely. Look at that author.
I know, Dr. Jonas Allard.
One of the greats.
An illustrious mind.
One of the greats. I get lost more than I is allowed for me to say. There will be a map in the game.
Azodio says, we move faster if we strafe jump. No, but you can just straight up run.
Yeah.
If you want to show them running.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
You can go to
the
left.
Yeah, that's where I'm going.
I like that we have Jonas Allard just up on screen, just permanently now.
God, this is one of my favorite.
Yeah, go all the way to the left.
Oh, that's one of my favorite. Like, look at that. Ollie did a really nice job telegrating that, and Jake did a good job building that shit. Looks really good. Sorry, what is it? Watch us think our game looks nice. Yeah. Oh, let's jump up to this guy. Come on. Oh, no! Uh-oh. Oh, perfect. Yeah, there's things like that where I'm like, oh, our action button and our throw button are the same button, and it's behaving intelligently right now, but this is the way you learn to what you need to fix about your game.
Yeah. Oh, I have to throw it away.
It feels like... Oh, I actually get tired walking uphill in games, mentally. Isn't that terrible? Isn't that really disgusting?
Sir Slade says, for the in-game map, will it require you to actually know how to use a map? We haven't finalized our map system. We're going to have a map. We need one because, you know, we don't want people to just get irredeemably lost.
That's right.
There will be kind of, you may have noticed at points when Delilah gives you a task, you'll get a brief little quest line up at the quest sort of text up at the top of your screen. You'll be able to...
I didn't throw it. Okay, hold on. Let me go to the edge.
You'll be able to call that back, and you'll be able to check your
map. No, that should be collision, but it's in the canon now. So we discovered that as a thing you need to fix.
And we're still figuring out what the map will be like, whether it's 100% fully enrolled map.
You got
or
it
she started
night,
talking.
I was sorry
trigger.
For just launching into the what the hell's wrong
with
we
were not
shit.
Wearing the headphones.
I just heard her talk.
Saying.
Yeah, I'm just not going to respond to her. That means I need to tag that line.
Anyway,
that's
it. So, K Bizzled says, did the whole game take place in the tower and surrounding forest, or were you loaded different maps? So the whole game world is one contiguous area. Like on the technical side, that's split up into a bunch of different scenes that we're loading and unloading using some really cool software called Sector for Unity. But like. The whole area is one big connected world, if that's what you mean. Chris Remo is my father, asks, will there be music in the game or will all music originate from the in-game world? Yeah, there will be music in the game. If you saw the gameplay run-through we did, there is a bit of music that is triggered when you see the vandalism at your tower, and that's an example of in-game music. And then obviously you also heard the music coming from the team's boombox at the lake. That was by a really cool LA-based duo called Cheap Talk, who do very, like, convincing 80s-esque pop music.
This might be rolling up. Oh, it's not. It's stopped. It went on the flats. What's the thickest book we have? Is it Steven's room? Just trying to think. If I'm going to put one in the toilet, I don't want one that's really going to last.
I don't think the toilet's in that spelled.
There's a pencil on the move. I swear I just saw it. There it is.
The same person asks, will there be wildlife? We're talking about ways to have kind of small wildlife in the game, you know, birds and squirrels and things like that. There was a concept early on about like a big bear that stalked you, but that kind of got rightfully dismissed as ridiculous.
How dare you? Pretty quickly. It's before you started here. We had all the bad ideas before you showed up.
Should mantle through the bottom
of the time. You can mantle
yeah.
across here? Seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, sick. Well, I didn't know that was existing. That's awesome. Are you kidding me? I didn't know that was true.
You can't put books in the house yet.
In this build? Okay. But still, it's going to go in here. You know, I'll set it on top of
it.
I'll put
it
on top of the generator.
Put it down.
Yeah, let's for later. Yeah. When I come to do my things later. I want a bench on the back. I want that to be put on the bench. So I don't know. I like this to sound a thing. It's uncomfortable. Cool. Maybe I'll just frame the tower nicely. Cool.
There you go. All right. Can you see Square Deck says? Can you see weird and interesting things from the tower?
Yeah, that's like so. The way you have to build this type of game is we kind of have to build all the on the ground stuff first and see how it's all shaped together. I mean, I can show you a crazy thing that I'm staring at, which is our first whiteboard map of the world. We'll do that on a later stream. But so we kind of have to figure all that stuff out, and then. We can build sightline, like interesting sightline continuity from the tower after that. One of like the first ideas for this game, I'm glad we didn't go this way because it would not have definitely not played to my strengths as somebody who makes games. But back when Jake and I were roommates and we were talking about, it was a long time ago, talking about a game that took place at the tower, there was this concept of it was being almost like a puzzle game where you observed things from your tower and then went out and found them and then found some sort of like mist-like puzzles and there were no people in the world and things like that, but I definitely want to preserve the fact that like this vantage point is uniquely it's unique, I should just say. There's definitely a story moment actually in day two where
you can also see the
daughter's
tower.
Yeah, can we look that way now and have it not look good?
Gary the Llama asks, have we...
Yeah, that's what
we're
doing.
Gary the Llama asks, have you guys been to a real Firewatch tower? And yeah, we actually totally have. We all went in May, I think, on a company like long weekend trip to Yosemite here in California, which is, you know, obviously not the same as a Wyoming national park, but is similar in a lot of ways. And it just so happened that a couple
there.
Miles from our campsite was a, oh yeah, you can see the last tower over there.
Mm-hmm.
A couple miles from our campsite was an actual real Firewatch tower in the vein of this one. And we all went up into it, and it still had all the original equipment and manuals. And like there was little Kodak film slides that were developed from, like taken from the tower, and like a guidebook of visitors that had dated back for years. It was really, really cool. It definitely gave us a lot of good insight into what this stuff is,
really?
What these towers are full of, and what the kind of people in them do.
I think I can
do
it tonight, can't I?
Yeah.
I have to
press.
I think
just keep pressing.
Nice.
I think no, you give me no forward. The stars also actually should have been all over them.
Yeah.
So cool.
Flashlight. So yeah, if you're just tuning into the stream, there's a lot of story stuff that happens in this game that's not happening because we're just kind of running through a debug build. But audio does, music just, I bet music just started. Responder.
Yep.
Yeah. There it is. Yeah, so there's Delilah's tower over there. It's really awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that was in the game.
Kay Bizzled says, will it be different weather effects? Yeah, we have a whole system for, like, time of day and weather that's not... Oh, I already answered this earlier. What am I doing? It's not based on a 24-hour clock. It's just based on what we...
Yeah, but there's a manager that's in the game that allows us to say, like, this is what the sky looks like, this is what the audio is like, this is what the sun is doing, this is what all that stuff is, like, coming together to make a time of day.
Yeah.
It's authored. Yeah, and we can interpolate between them.
So we're coming up on an hour here. Do we want to maybe just kind of recap the what this game's all about and close it out?
Yeah. Why don't you do that, Chris? I always do it. Yeah.
Stephanie asks, who's working on music? That's me. Although the in-game music is the like in-game boombox music is a cool band called Cheap Talk in LA. Okay. So yeah, this was Firewatch from Campo Santo, where we work, us two and Jane and seven other people. Firewatch is a first-person story-driven exploration game set in the Shoshone National Forest in Wyoming in 1989. You play Henry, a guy who has, due to some kind of sticky issues in his personal life, taking a job as a Firewatch lookout for about 3 months. So you head out to this tower and fairly quickly weird occurrences draw you out of your tower and kind of set you on the path of this mystery that starts to envelop you and impact your relationship with your supervisor, Delilah, with whom you are in constant communication. For the duration of the game.
Somebody has to look down, please, of course.
So that is what this game is. There's a lot of exploration, a lot of traversal, a lot of player-driven dialogue. That's what we're making.
Yeah, so thanks for tuning in, and we've sort of said it a few times now, but we'll definitely be doing more of these. So subscribe if you're interested, and you can keep up with the development on our blog, and we post a lot of the things that happen at the company on Twitter. And those are all just like at Campo Santo or camposanto.com.
Yep.
Thanks so much, and
thanks,
we'll see you guys soon.
Yeah.
Thanks for all your interest. It's been like a crazy
post-PAX,
like, haze we're in, so thank you so much.